Hi, good morning, Canyon Hills. I hope you had a great Thanksgiving. It's good to see you. I invite you to stand, join us as we worship this morning. Yeah, there we go. This morning, we're going to sing a song about God's grace, and we're just going to celebrate the grace that He gives us. So if you join me and put your hands together like this, and I'm going to lead you to the song. It goes like this, church.
Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve grace on top of grace. More than I've asked for, more than I'm worth, grace on top of grace. I sing the sound, once lost, now found. Heaven came down and grace rescued me. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Grace on top of grace. It's more than I've asked for, more than I'm worth. Grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. With your grace on top of grace. With your grace on top of grace.
That you give us. God, we sing this out to you.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It wasn't mine till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I've tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you.
And you call.
And you call my name. And I ran out of that grave.
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name. Worship you. We thank you, God, for the grace that you've given us. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Church, in Psalm 16, verses 7 to 11, it says this: I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. My body rests in his safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever. This morning, church, may we bless the one who gives us life. May we bless the one who gives us hope, the one who gives us joy in his presence, the God of comfort. So as we sing this next song, may we just have that in mind, and may we bless our God together.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord.
Come on, you give life.
Darkness, you give hope, you restore.
will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Oh God, this morning, may we just remember why we sing. And it's all for you, God. I pray, God, that our voices, that our song, that our music just be a blessing to your ear. Thank you, God, that you are so good. Thank you, God, that you bless us with your presence, that you bless us with your access, that we can just call on Jesus, and right there we have access to the Father. So, God, I pray this morning that we are just reminded of that, that you just give us new energy, new hope, new faith, God, as we just grow closer to you. So I pray that you prepare our minds, prepare our hearts, and God, as we just get ready for your word this morning, we just worship you, God. So we thank you and we love you, and all God's children say, amen. Amen. Amen, church. You may be seated.
I mean, to put on your fridge or to take them and hand them out to your family and your friends and your coworkers as we just enter into the Christmas season, learning all that God has in store for us. It's going to be great. So make sure that you grab that flyer. If you need more, the ushers have them outside. It's going to be great as we have hope. So take that flyer. Once again, it's great. It's graphically looks pretty. And there's some great things happening there. Also, if you know, as we continue the Christmas season, if you brought your tithes and offerings, you can always drop that in the offering plate at the back of the room as well. Okay, we can end it there. That's fine.
That comes.
Well, good morning, Canyon Hills. It's so great to see all of you this morning, and happy post-Thanksgiving. Hopefully all of you had a great chance just to be with family and friends and just celebrate all that God has done in your life over this past year. This morning we're going to be continuing and actually finishing in our series from the book of Romans. So if you have your Bibles, please open up to Romans chapter 15. That's where we're going to be in just a minute. You know, over the last 12 weeks, we have been through a lot as we've studied through Romans, and we have seen Paul set this beautiful foundation for us of really what it means to be a believer, to have faith, and to grab a hold of the call that God has placed in all of our lives. And we talked about these four different divisions that Paul had in the book of Romans. It was the wrath of God, the grace of God, the plan of God, and the will of God. And we were able to kind of trace this theme all the way through the chapters as we've gone on. And he started by saying, hey, look, the playing field is leveled for all of us. In reality, as human beings, there are times we know what's right to do and what's wrong to do, but yet there's still something inside of us that makes us do these wrong things. Even though we may not want to, even though we may have the desire not to do it, we know it's bad, we still do bad things from time to time. It's part of our human nature. And those bad things really go against what God would want us to do, because God created us and he knows what's best for us. And so he wants us to make these decisions, but yet sometimes we still make these bad decisions. And when we make these bad decisions, we end up sinning and rebelling against what we know that God has called us to. And as sinners in rebellion, we are now deserving of the judgment that comes from God. When he says, hey, this is the right thing to do. I want you to do this thing. But if you do that bad thing, well, there's going to be consequences to it. And this is what Paul talks about when it comes to the wrath of God, and how the wrath of God is something that all of us experience and are held underneath. And it's interesting because we arranged our worship set this morning. Each of the four songs that we're going to be singing correspond to the four different parts of the book of Romans. And when we're talking about wrath, we opened up, the first song, Glorious Day. And in this song, it says that we were buried beneath our shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb until I met you. And it says we were breathing but not alive. We were caught in these graves. There was this sin. There was this death that awaited us. This separation from God and living in the world. And that's part of that wrath is, you know what? If you're going to make these bad decisions, there's a death that awaits, unfortunately. But God loves us too much to leave us there, and so he gives us grace. He sent us his son to die for us on the cross, to take upon that wrath, to take upon that judgment, so we wouldn't have to experience it. And that's where grace on top of grace comes in. I love that song because I was free from sin and the penalty. At the cross you took my place, how you love me I don't deserve. Those are all lines from that song, Grace on Top of Grace. And that's what it is. God loves us so much, he gave us a way out of that wrath that we didn't deserve. But that's not the end of the story. Just because we're saved and we have freedom, that's not where God says, okay, that's it, we're done with you. No, this is supposed to be the start of something new, the start of something great and glorious in life, that this newfound grace, this freedom from death and sin would change us. It would lead us into a life where we want to try our best to make better decisions, to be better people, to do better things, to have transformation in community, to hear the calling from God and to go and do it, to step into the purpose that he has for us. And that's the third part, which is his plan. And we sung about that in the song, Great Are You, Lord. It's his breath would fill our lungs, that he would just encompass us, that he would embody us, he would come inside, and everything that we would do would just be in glory to who he is, as our lives are changed as a result of it. But that changing goes one step further. That changing then becomes this idea that when we start to live out what God has called us to do, that we become united, that we become one mind, one body, one entity as the church, as the people of God, to bring praise to the Lord for what he has done. The fact that he's rescued us from death, that he's rescued us from the wrath, that he gave us his son as a sign of grace, that he's got a plan for us to make us better, to be happier, to have hope and joy fill our lives. And that's his will. And that's what we're gonna sing at the very end of our service when we sing the song, Hosanna, where there's two lines there. It says, show me how to love like you love me, and then break my heart for what breaks yours. He wants us to be so in tune, to be so united, to be so one with him, that when we look at the world, when we see people around us, our hearts break for the devastation. Our hearts break for the hatred and the animosity and the divisions that we see, and we would truly learn what it means to love one another, to be united. That's his will for us. And so Paul paints this beautiful picture through the book of Romans of wrath that moves into grace, that moves into God's plan, and then ends with God's will. And that's what we're going to focus on this morning as we close out Romans, the will of God as we step into chapter 15. And Carlos started with it last week, but as we get a little bit into 15, Paul gives this beautiful prayer to kind of summarize what he's talking about here. Look at this in Romans 15, 5 through 6. He says, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is such an amazing prayer. Such a good prayer. This is something that we should be praying every single day of our lives when we wake up. Every morning when we get up, we should say, God, I don't know what today is going to throw at me, but I pray that you give me endurance and you give me encouragement to see it through. And not only that, that when the world tries to come at me, when the world tries to lead me astray or to push me further away from you and getting into the world's ways, I pray that you would make me united with my brothers and sisters in Christ. United with you in my mind, in my heart, in my actions, in my deeds, and allow me to be loving to everyone that I meet. Can you imagine how different your lives, your day would be if you started every single morning praying that? How you interact with your coworkers, how you interact with your family, how you interact with your friends, the random people that you meet in the supermarkets or in the stores, wherever you go, that you would have this mindset of the world's coming against me, but I'm going to choose to show the love of God anyway. And I'm going to offer forgiveness and that grace and that mercy when the world wants to do otherwise. That would transform us. That would really change our lives and how we live it out. And what's beautiful about this is that this is the same prayer that Jesus prays in John 17. When he says, I pray that they would be like-minded, that they would be of one mind. It's Jesus' heart that we would be united together for a common cause, a common good. And what is that common good? It's to show the love of Jesus Christ to everyone that we meet, to show something different than what this world has to offer. But how do we do that? I mean, that sounds great, right? We can read it in scripture, we can talk about it, but when it comes, push comes to shove, when we actually have to show love towards people who may be different than us, how do we do that? How do we put aside our wants and our desires in order to help somebody else up? What does that actually look like? How do we set aside our preferences to benefit another? And that's what Pastor Carlos talked about last week. And I loved it when he talked about the essential versus the non-essential things in life. And what I got from that is that every single day, you and I, we have an opportunity. We have an opportunity to put aside our preferences, to put aside what we want to do and find ways to build other people up, to encourage other people, to show love to other people rather than benefiting ourselves in the moment. And it's not something that comes naturally to us. It's something that we pray the Holy Spirit helps reveal inside of us, but every day there are opportunities to do this. Here's an example for you of what this looks like. Many years ago, when I was much younger and I had less gray hair in my beard, I got to be the coach of a girls' JV volleyball team. And see, I'm the young guy here on the side, very young, right? Didn't even have my full masculine looks yet. But I got to be this coach, and we were a very small team from a Christian private school, and we didn't play a lot of the other really big schools, but we had a really good group of girls. And one time we were out on the road traveling in a travel game, and I remember as we're sitting in the match, I'm sitting on the sideline, and these girls are just getting attacked again and again and again. There's this hitter on the other side of the court who is just hitting the same spot over and over and over again. And part of me was thinking, well, maybe the girls don't see it where they're at inside of their positions. And so I call the timeout. I bring the girls in. And I say, hey, we're just getting hit. Like, you guys, you need to communicate. You need to talk. You need to move together as a team. And we strategized on a new formation, how to reposition yourself in the court to be able to better receive and to be able to block the attacks. And I felt encouraged by it. I was like, hey, that was a really good pep talk, girls. Go back out there, and we're going to stop this. And so they go back out, and the next serve comes, and it hits the same spot again. And then again, and again, and again. And we end up losing the match. And at the very end of the game, during our huddle at the very end, I could have just yelled because inside I was angry. I was frustrated. I wanted to say, you didn't listen. Clearly I could see. Clearly I knew what was going on, but you're not paying attention. You don't want to play together as a team. You know what? Just go run laps. I could have gotten really upset and showed that hate and that hurt and punished them for not listening or behaving. But when they walked off that court, do you know what I saw? They were already punishing themselves because they knew what was wrong. They knew what went wrong. So in that moment, even though I was upset, I was frustrated because I knew best because I was the coach, I decided to put my preferences aside because I could see their pain. I could see their hurt, and I approached it differently. And I said, hey, you know what? It's okay. I believe that you have the desire to learn. I believe that you want to work together as a team. I believe you want to communicate. And I have faith in you that if we practice harder, if we work together more as a team, that we'll get this next time. And so that's what we're going to do. I'm going to commit to you that we're going to work harder in our practices. We're going to work and strengthen the areas that we may feel that we're weak because I believe in you and that you are capable of more than you know. And they left encouraged, and we changed our practices, and we ended up going on to win first place in our division. And I'm not saying that to brag about medals or achievements. What I'm saying is that our world is a world that is so quick to hit us when we're down. That when we're feeling that pain, when we're feeling that punishment, when we're feeling the hurt, our world just digs it in deeper. But what would it look like if we put aside our preferences to show love, to build up, to encourage others rather than to tear them down? How would that change our lives? I think about a server who just got hired at a restaurant, who has three failed orders back to back at the very beginning of their shift. And the manager could call them in and say, you know what, you're a horrible server, you're fired, get out of here. But what if the manager shifted up and said, hey, you know what, I know the first day jitters are real. I know that there's anxiousness, I know that there's some nervousness, so we're just gonna slow down. We're gonna take it easy, we're gonna double check our orders, and then we're gonna go back out there because I believe that you can get it right. How would that change the mindset of that server? How would it change the way that they interact with the customers? It would revolutionize how they live, how they approach that day. See, that's what Jesus is calling us to here. Every day you have an opportunity to see the world that's hurting around you, to see your friends, your family, your coworkers, your neighbors, your relatives who are hurting. You see the opportunities to empower, to encourage, to build up, to show love instead of to show hatred, to show hurt, to show pain. See, that's what God is calling us to. And I know that it's not easy. It's not something that comes naturally, but God gives us the Holy Spirit to help us see these opportunities so that we can express love. And why do we do it? Well, back in verse 6, what did it say? It said with the goal that we would be with one mind and one voice to glorify God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He does this so we can all be united. We can work together for one good. The amazing grace of God is so beautiful that it takes you and me and it gives us the ability to love people who have different backgrounds, who have different viewpoints, who have different biases or different stances than we do. The love of God allows us as broken, imperfect people to really be united together to do something great in His name, to build up the church and to change the world around us. And on a side note real quick, you know, I've always struggled with that phrase that God's going to use you to change the world. And I know that sounds weird as a pastor to say that. And it's always just something that's been in the back of my mind as I've said it, as I've heard other pastors say it, because that's a lot of responsibility, isn't it? To think about that. If you hear somebody say, you know, God's going to use you to change the world. And you're like, oh my gosh, I'm one person. The world's such a big place. I recently heard an Irish theologian called Malcolm Duncan, and he spoke about this. And it was really cool because it changed my perspective I want to share with you this morning. And he said, that's a lot of pressure that exists there, but what we need to know is simply this. You can't change the world. Only God can change the world. But He chooses to use you as an instrument of that change. So the pressure isn't on you to change the world because that's God's doing. That's what God's going to do. You just have to be willing to be used by Him to accomplish His purpose. That's a lot less stressful, isn't it? And that's part of what Paul is talking about here. He wants to use us to really show the world what love looks like, what being united looks like, not being divided. To being in one mind, in harmony with who God is, what God is doing in our lives, and showing the forgiveness and mercy and grace to the world around us, which can change the world. It's such a beautiful thing. And Paul, he goes on in the next couple passages, and he's talking about how this concept of God and salvation and His hope and the changing, it's not something that's new. It's been around from the very beginning, and he's going to bring the idea of Israel back in one more time. And he says, hey, look, this promise of God, of Jesus coming to offer us saving grace, a forgiveness, a mercy from wrath, it's been something promised all the way back from the very beginning of the Israelites. In fact, look what he says here in verses 8 through 9. He says, for I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promises made to the patriarchs might be confirmed, and moreover, the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy. You see, for generations, all of Israel had looked, they had longed, they had hoped for this Savior, this Messiah to come and to rescue them, and to bring them into this eternal kingdom forever. It was central to their faith, to their culture. And when we can see it traced down, God spoke to Abraham and said, hey, Abraham, I'm going to make your descendants more numerous than the stars, and you're going to be blessed because of it. And then we saw it go down to Isaac and Jacob and then travel all the way down to David when God said, hey, David, someone from your direct lineage will be this Messiah, will step into this throne. It's been a part of their culture. It's been a part of their history. And so for the Israelite people, the hope of Jesus has always been that God would come and restore them, that God would come and save them, provide something different than the world would have to offer for them, and rescue them from where they were. And so Paul, he moves on and he says, that promise that went out to the Israelites, it's the same promise that you and I have today. That when this world shows hatred and hurt and punishment, that there is a better way. There is something, a hope that we all can long for, that God wants to bring us into, that he wants to invite us into so we can truly live in that love of God, feeling free from the pressures of the world around us. And he goes and he lists off a whole bunch of Old Testament passages in the next couple of verses, kind of painting this beautiful picture. And what he really gets to, what I love, is this beautiful picture of the gospel. And he says, hey, look, this is what it comes down to. The chosen people of God were the Jewish people, right? And the Jewish people, they went through some really bad, hard times in their life. They knew punishment. They knew pain. They knew hardships and hurt and confusion and hopelessness. And in the midst of that, they also knew God. That God was faithful to come and redeem them, to come and rescue them, to come and help them. So the chosen people of God, the Jews, would find ways to glorify God for what he's doing in their lives. And now the non-Jews, the Gentiles, would be able to see the Jewish people and say, hey, why are they praising? Why are they glorifying this God when they've had so much hardship in their life? And when they could hear their story and see their praises, it would spur something in them to say, man, I want that too. Because I can relate. I've been hopeless. I've been hurt. I've been in pain. I've been frustrated. Maybe if I can praise God and know this God, I could glorify God too. And eventually what happens is these Jewish people and these non-Jewish people, the Gentiles, would find themselves glorifying God together. And all of the world would sing praises united to God in one mind, in one body, in one spirit, thanking him and praising him from the grace that we don't deserve. See, that's the truth of the gospel. That's what God is leading us into, that we would be united together to bring praises and to bring glory to the name of God. That we would stand together united. That's our goal. That's our hope. That's what we long for as believers. It's the hope of God. And then Paul, he steps into verse 13 here. And verse 13 is probably one of my favorite verses over the last 3 years. It's a verse that I've really clung to and I've understood more deeply in this season of my life than ever before. And every time I read it, it means something more to me as he talks about the hope of God. Listen to this. He says, may the hope, or the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. See, there are seasons of our lives where we face hopelessness, where we find ourselves in despair. Sometimes they pass quickly, sometimes they don't. Sometimes those feelings of hopelessness, they open up old wounds from the past of scars and hurts and pains, and they leave us in a place of desperation, a place of feeling things are never going to get better. And I think the Israelites knew what this felt like, right? They had heard this promise from the very beginning of their life that God was going to come and rescue them and bring them into this kingdom. But all they knew was warfare and wandering. They were people without a name, without a land, without a home, really without a people. They knew what it was like to feel hopeless, to long for something, but it just seemed to never come. The last 3 years of my life, I have gotten to know this as well. Most of you have known, I've mentioned over the last 3 years, Tiffany and I's story of our infertility and our struggle to get pregnant, and how so many times in my life in the last 3 years, I found myself on my knees praying, God, show me a sign. God, give me something, an answer. Give me something to cling to as we're longing. We know this desire you've placed on our hearts to have another child, but yet it's not happening. No matter what we do, no matter how hard we try, it's just not happening, Father. I don't get it. I don't understand. It's 3 years. It feels hopeless. And I felt hopeless before in my lives, but this time it was different. It hit a lot deeper this time. And that hopelessness, it was hard to get through. And things didn't really change for us until we learned to truly surrender and take on the mindset that we saw at the very beginning of Romans 15. where we would get up each day and say, God, I don't know what answers we're going to get today from results. God, I don't know what you're going to say. I don't know what you're going to do, but I pray that you empower us. I pray that you encourage us, that you make us united together, and you still allow us to show love to one another and love to you regardless of the outcome. And it wasn't until we learned that surrender that the things started to change. And we've made it through some pretty successful milestones now. And if you were here at the Thanksgiving Night of Praise, you would have heard us share our story and our testimony. And I can faithfully and joyfully say now that Tiffany is 14 weeks pregnant with a very healthy growing baby. And we're so excited. And I share this because I can testify that our God is a God of hope. Our God is a God who wants to restore joy. Our God is a God who wants to give you peace in His timing, not in ours. He's going to do things the way that He knows best. He knows our lives. He knows our wants. He knows our desires. He knows what we're capable of way more than we do. And we just have to learn to trust in Him and His timing, even when it's hard. Because that's what He's calling us to. He wants to give us that hope. You see, our God is a God of hope. You know, the word hope in the Greek, it means an expectation of what is sure. You see, our God is a God of what is sure. This world is just going to keep dangling false lies and temptations in front of us to lead us astray. But God is the only one that we can be sure of. His plan, His will, His path, His grace is far greater than we could ever deserve or ever get on our own. And we just have to learn to tap into it. We have to learn to trust Him in those seasons of our lives. And that's what Paul is praying for. He says, I pray that the God of hope would fill you with joy and peace that would overflow in your lives. He doesn't just give it to anybody. No, He only gives it to those who truly choose to trust and believe in Him and the sacrifice that His Son made for us upon the cross. And I think that it would be such a tragedy for us to go through life feeling like we're stuck in this rut of despair and hopelessness and not grab a hold of the overflowing peace and grace and hope that God can give us because we don't want to trust in God. And I'll admit firsthand, there were times in the 3 years past that I had a hard time trusting. I don't know if that's what took so long. I don't know, but I will tell you that once we truly learned that surrender and we truly chose to trust in God with our circumstances, man, He was quick to answer. And He was faithful to answer. And so the question for you this morning is, what circumstance in your life right now, what are you dealing with? What are you currently facing that maybe God is asking you to trust Him with? As we've seen God move through the entire book of Romans, that God is a rescuer, God is a redeemer, God's got grace for you, He's got a plan for you, He's got a path for you, He's got a calling for you, He's got a purpose for you, He wants to use you, He wants to transform you. What is it in your life right now that you're dealing with that maybe you're having a hard time trusting when God is saying, trust, and it'll happen. It'll happen in my timing and not in yours. See, we don't have to be held captive in these seasons of hopelessness and despair because we have a God of hope. We have a God that wants to give us joy and peace if we truly learn to lean on Him and trust in Him with all things in our lives. And it's available for you and for me. Paul wraps up his main point as he finishes out Romans 15 by saying this: I myself am convinced, my brothers and sisters, that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with knowledge, you're competent to instruct one another. And yet I have written you quite boldly on some points to remind you of them again, because of the grace God gave me to be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles. He gave me the priestly duty of proclaiming the gospel of God so that the Gentiles might become an offspring acceptable to God, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, I glory in Christ Jesus in my service to God. See, Paul is writing and says, I've spoken a lot to you, Romans, about calling, about purpose, about wrath, about grace, about plan, about will, about what God is leading you into. And I've challenged you. And I want to tell you that I, too, myself, I know what I've been called to. I'm not just saying it to you. This is something I'm living out, too. I've been called to be a minister to the Gentiles. And I love the part that he says here. He says, and I know that I've kind of spoken pretty boldly. It means, if you look it up in the original language, it says, I have spoken really harsh, upsetting words to you. And I love it because at this point, Paul probably didn't even know most of his audience. He's never really met them at this point in time. He says, I know that I've spoken really harshly against you, even though I don't know you, but once again, he's going to now live out what he just preached about. He's not leaving them in this point where he's saying, I've spoken really hard words, now get where you act right, or I'm going to come and see you. No, he finds a way to encourage them. He lists three things he says to encourage them. He says, I know you're full of goodness, you are complete in knowledge, and you're competent to instruct one another. See, what Paul is saying in here is simply this. I know you have it in you to do what's right. I know that you know the Word of God. I know that you know what he's placing on your life. I know that you know he's called you to something great, and I just ask that you be spiritually mature about it. So you don't fight with one another. You don't find a ways to flaunt what you have or what you don't have in front of one another. That you would just be united. That you would come together being spiritually mature and be united and learn from one another. What I see Paul saying here is never think that you're too old that you can't learn something. Never think that you're too young that you have nothing to offer. No, instead, we all benefit when we work together. We all benefit when we become united. When in one mind, in one love, in one body, we praise God for what he is doing. We share our wisdoms. We share our learnings. We share the way that God has moved and lived and breathed and transformed our lives with one another, and let it be an encouragement to someone else in the midst of their hardships. But it only happens if we're united. If we come together in one mind and one body. And Paul, he writes as he closes all this up, and he says, hey, you know what? I know that I've never met you, Romans, but I want to visit you. I'm in Corinth now, but I'm going to make plans to come and see you on my way to Spain. So I ask that you pray for me, that you pray for safe travels, and that you pray that God would complete joy and that same hope inside of my life. And then when he gets to chapter 16, it's interesting because if you read through 16, Paul lists off over 30 different names of people, most of whom we know absolutely nothing about. And a lot of people would just probably skip over Romans 16 and be like, okay, that's cool. It's like, greetings to Eunice, greetings to this person, greetings to this person. It's like, yeah, that's fantastic, but I don't care anything about that. But here's what's important about that. These names in Romans 16, they're real people written to a real church. In a real time in history. This isn't some cut and paste letter. It's not something that was written by ChatGPT and put inside of our Bibles. This is the living, breathing word of God as spoken through Paul to the Romans, saying, this is a message I have for the church in Rome that we are still reading today, because it's a message for you and for I as well. Because there's a lot of similarities between what was happening in Rome and what's happening in the church in America today. And what Paul is summarizing as he gets to the heart of it all is he says simply this, we're sinners. We're deserving of God's wrath, but God gives us grace instead. And that grace is something that we should praise him for, that we should be united together, showing love to one another, singing praises out loud to God rather than being divided against each other. And in fact, he mentions this in 16, verse 17. He says this, I urge you, brothers and sisters, to watch out for those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teachings that you have learned. Keep away from them. See, in life, there are going to be people who will lead you astray. There will be people and situations and times and opportunities in life that are going to try to pull you away from what God is calling you into. But what Paul is saying here is simply this. If you're united with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ, if you're united with me, man, you're able to stand against those attacks. But he's also challenging us here. And I love his challenge, and this is the same challenge I want to leave you with this morning, is that when you hear something, don't just take it as truth. And I even encourage you to do that about my message this morning or any of the messages we've preached up here. I don't want you to walk out of these doors and say, man, that was such a great message from Pastor Matt. I'm going to believe every single word that he said. No, I want you to challenge that. I want you to go home, get into the Word, get into Scripture, to read it, to learn it, to own it for yourselves. Because when you begin to get into it, it becomes alive for you. And it makes it easier when those moments in life, when something comes against you, when the world pushes back against you, when the world tries to divide you from Christ, you don't say, well, that's not what Pastor Matt said. No, you're able to go and say, that's not what my God says. Because I know his word. Because I'm living in his word, not through humans' words. And that's what Paul's calling us to be united together, not just in our love, but in the truth that his word brings to you and to me every single day, so we can stand against the attacks of the devil. And I love how Paul closes, and it's how I want to close this morning. In 16 verse 20, he says this, "May the God of peace soon crush Satan under your feet." Can I get an amen for that? Isn't that such an amazing passage? How encouraging is that? Paul is saying, if you're united, if you understand the grace, if you live in that transformational love that God has for you, your God is faithful. Your God is true. Your God is the one sure thing in life that gives you hope to know he will crush Satan under your feet. So once again, whatever it is you're facing this morning, maybe you're living in that wrath, that feeling of being weighed down, held captive in the weight of doubt or sin or in your grave. God is saying there's a way out. There's a way out for you if you choose to believe. If you choose to trust in him and be united, putting aside your wants, your desires, finding ways to build other people up, to show others the love of God and watch how it transforms your life. Be transformed this morning by the love that God has for you and use it to encourage and empower others this week. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray that you just lead us. Father, that you would lead us through your Spirit. As we go through the day, as we go through the weeks, as we go through the months, Father, I pray that you would just bring to our minds the truth of your word. Father, the implications of what it means for anything that we encounter today. Father, I pray that you would just allow us to say yes to your will. Father, we would say yes to your power that you want to put inside of us to stand against the division, to stand against the attacks of the world. Father, to live out this yes in our lives. And Father, I pray that you open our eyes as you create and you reveal opportunities for us to proclaim your love to others today. And I pray as we go through these weeks, as we go through this season, Father, as we hear these songs, Father, the grace on top of grace, or glorious day, or great are you, Lord, or Hosanna, that it would just bring back all of the things that your word has spoken to us through this series. That it would encourage us, that it would challenge us, Father, that it would take us to another place where we can stand united, giving you all the glory and the praise. Father, thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace that we don't deserve. Thank you for your mercy. And Father, I pray that you would just open our eyes and show us how to love like you do. Break our hearts for what breaks yours. And let us show more of you in the world around us. Pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Church, I invite you to stand as we close out in worship together.
Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see the King of glory. Washing over all our sins, the people sing, the people sing.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna.
As a church, as a family, as one sound, one voice. God, we thank you and we bless you. Amen. So church, thank you for just joining us. It's always a joy to be together. Just one quick friendly reminder that next Friday is our women's dinner. We have a booth outside for signups. It would be awesome to see you there. Even for the guys, we're there to serve the women as well. So it's just a fun time for everyone. Other than that, I hope you have an amazing rest of the Sunday. God bless, and we'll see you again soon.
Hosanna, Hosanna.